It was a miracle that he saved you, first of all. That was the first miracle. And that he's keeping you day by day is next. All to be kept by God. Oh, my Lord. As I looked at your theme, you've already prayed, we've prayed. As I looked at your theme as it came to me, being armed, for you have armed me with strength for the battle. A lot of times we don't realize the battle that we're in. A lot of times we're not discerning the battles that we are in. I was looking at your form on the wall of the different forms of prayer, the different positions of prayer, and as intercessors, you will find yourself in each and every one of those positions right there. As an intercessor going before the Father, and you're pleading and you're interceding and supplicating for others, you've got to be on your face. At the time that we're in right now, you better be armed for the battle. Run with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Hallelujah. And we're going to start at the 10th verse. Then we're going to go to 2 Corinthians, chapter 10, verses 4 to 5. I'm going to ask that you to stand for the reading of God's word. Amen. Yes. Folks, stand for everything else. You need to stand for God's word and give God's word power where it is due.
Amen.
Because it's this word that you're standing on today. Yes. It is your word that you're living throughout today.
Amen.
The word reads, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the evil in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 and 5. For though we, only in verse 3, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God. For pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into the captivity to the obedience of Christ. You may be seated. Hallelujah. When I look at your theme and where we start from, and looking at 2 Samuel, the scripture was read in our hearing earlier in 2 Samuel. You need to understand that 2 Samuel is dealing with David's ascendance. David, the eighth son of Jesse, was now being, he was going to be anointed as king over Israel. So in 2 Samuel, it opens up with the death of Saul and his son Jonathan on the battlefield of Mount Gilboa. David is then anointed king over Judah, his own tribe. There is a power play right going on right about now in 2 Samuel with the house of Saul and the house of David.
Amen.
All right? The commander in chief of the armies is about 7.5 years before the nation is unified under David. But there's a long war between Saul's house and David's house. But David grew stronger and stronger, and Saul weaker and weaker. David unified both the political and the religious life of the nation by bringing back the Ark of the Covenant from the house of Abinadab. They looked over there and seen Abinadab was getting blessed, so he brought the Ark of the Covenant back. One of the things he did as he came in as commander-in-chief, as king of Israel, that was the first thing he brought back the word. God established a covenant with David and his kingdom, which established the coming king, the Messiah. David was a warrior and successfully deflects the enemies of Israel. Though David repents for his sins, the word says, the sword shall never depart from David's house. David and his son Absalom have a long estrangement and rebellion is set against the king. Absalom dies by the hand of Joab, and as he hangs by his hair, David repents for the numbering of fighting the men of Israel and builds an altar and presents his offering to the Lord. And there we have 2 Samuel, where your theme came from. David was a warrior.
Yes.
David knew how to fight, and David would fight. There is a cliche that says, in the time of peace, prepare for war. War is all around us. In case you just haven't noticed, but war is on the edge. War is on the brink of even where we are right now. And if there ever was a time that we were going to battle, we were going to battle and understanding what our fight is. Many times we go into a battle and we don't understand what the fight is, so we're fighting at anything and anybody. We don't take the time to discern, God, is this you or is this the devil? Because sometimes we're fighting stuff that we should not be fighting. But the Bible talks about what we just read of the principalities and powers in high places. High places, places of authority. So you need to understand what your battle is. And some things you don't need to fight. Some things you got to ask God. God, is this you? Because guess what? Something that he's putting in place, he's allowing to happen because he's getting your attention. He's doing something in you. He's building something in you. He wants to build some character in you and in me. So the battle is going to be ongoing. Dressed for the battle? The stomach is dressed to kill but afraid to fight. If you were ever permitted to fight, you knew that you had to mentally get ready for a fight. If somebody was telling you, you know, after school, it's going down, I'm going to get you. So, you know, the rest of the day, you're kind of preparing yourself mentally for that fight. Because you said, okay, we're going to get it on. And you're not thinking about anything else. You know, anything else that day except that I know there's a fight going on after school. I know I did that. Somebody told me, I remember the girl told me, she said, guess what? I'm going to get you after school because I reported her for talking. I did what the teacher told me to do. So she got mad. So it was going to go down. And I knew that I wasn't about to fight. Don't know as girls who told you to fight. But you better fight. You better fight in the spirit. Some of y'all know what it is. You were able to go out there and fight, took off them earrings, beads up your face, and y'all got it on. You got it on. And some of us, you know, we can take that and say, okay, you beat me. So since I'm going to get in trouble anyway, I'm out of my broken muscle. And you have to get like that with the enemy. You need to understand that you're fighting for your family, you're fighting for your children, there's a lot of things that we need to fight for that the devil has stolen from us. And we need to be on our face for it. But we need to know what battles to fight. And the only way we're going to know what battles to fight is that we need to have that discernment. God is with you. So if I'm dressed for battle, I'm dressed to kill with a train to fight, I can't have that fear to fight. I've got to come out, you know, I used to watch boxing with my father on Saturday nights. Just to be with my dad, I would sit and pick at his face while he's watching the fight. And I said, well, what is he getting out of these fights? He'd be going like that. And he'd be jumping and he'd be fighting just like he was in the ring. And I watched all that, you know, and that's what people do when they really want to get into it. But you really better get into the part of prayer and learning how to speak in the spirit and learning how to pray in the spirit and pull some stuff down out of the spirit.
Amen.
It's time to fight. It ain't no time to sit down. It's no time to keep your mouth shut. In war, it's not the time to shut up. It's not the time to be quiet, but it's the time for you to be spitting out the word of God. God, this is what your word says, and I'm giving it back to you. Going on a day when we're praying prayers that don't mean anything, a prayer that you can get to the ceiling and bounce them back, and we're wondering, well, what is going on, God? What is happening here? I need an answer from you. And a lot of times we don't want to sit and wait long enough to get an answer from God.
Amen.
All right, because we want it quick. The day of the microwave Christian.
Amen.
You call prayer and you don't see anybody coming. But when the trouble comes, people know how to call. People know how to call you up real fast and say, would you pray for me? Such a thing is happening. They know who to go to the office and ask to come to pray. Come on, let me bring you over here. I just want to ask, would you just pray for me? I just need that. Won't step their foot in the church, but they know who to go to ask for prayer. So you better stay prayed up. We are in a battle against the enemy, and guess what? He is very subtle. He's very subtle. But what you think he is not doing, that is what he is doing. When Lucifer rebelled against God, he managed to take a third of the angels with him. And this world has been in a war ever since. He put together this military, okay, this military team and set up his force to kill, to steal, and to destroy you. And for some, he's done a pretty good job. But I'm here to tell you, and to serve notice from the devil, he can't have what I got. It may not look the way I want it to look right now, but he can't have what I got. And sometimes you kind of get a little bit faint in the battle and you say, Lord, what is going on right here? But you've got to keep the faith and I've got to keep spitting out the word of God. And say, Father, I thank you because he will be what you said he will be. He will be the man of God that you called him to be. She will be the woman of God that you called him to be. No matter what it looks like right now. So guess what? For some of us, it's not looking too well. Regardless of where I'm at right now, it's not looking that well. Finances don't look that well. But I've got to keep the faith. I've got to keep giving. That's not the time to stop giving. It's not the time to stop praying. It's not the time to give up. So those that don't believe that Satan exists, they don't armor up. The word says put on the full armor, the whole armor. The whole armor of God. So that means I've got to put on everything. The helmet of salvation. I've got to put up the shield of faith. And the shield is what I like because it's that shield of faith. Because if I'm walking in faith and not by sight, it's the shield that's going to take those darts that the enemy is sending after me, is sending at me. So I must dress in the armor. But if you don't believe that there's a battle, you won't dress up. If you don't believe that there's a fight, you won't get dressed. And you will let it go right by you. And a lot of us Christians have let a lot of things go right by us because we weren't dressed for battle. And we kept our mouths shut. But I see a lot of people on Facebook today, they're saying whatever they want to say and how they need to say it. But this is the time where we better be praying before the Lord our God and spitting out that word. Regardless of who is in office, you need to spit out the word. None of them are right. Can we say that? None of them will be correct. But I know who God is, and you must know who God is. And understand that he and his team was put together, Satan's team was put together so that he could study you. And he studies you, and he goes there, and they go back and they report to him where your vulnerable areas are. I can get them right there. I can get them in their pocketbook. Take that away from them, and guess what? You won't see them in church. No car, I'm going to get on a bus to do what? Go away. We don't want to go through anything this day because we are so lazy. As a body of Christ, we are truly, truly lazy. We have had it so well in this United States of America, but I believe, if you go to a third world country, from what I have seen, I haven't been there. They told me I couldn't get it. So I haven't been there. But I've seen how people can walk to church. Because they understood what it was to go and worship God. We are so spoiled in this nation until we can dial up something in the middle. I can stay home. I can dial up a sermon. I can dial up whatever I want. And I can stay right in my bed. I don't have to move. Go to church for what? That's where the hypocrites are. Well, guess what? That's where they're supposed to be. Because they need Jesus too. When are we going to get it and learn how to love the unlovely? Because you were there once.
Amen.
So he takes this team and they study you. They study your likes and their dislikes. They know what makes your toes curl. Yeah, I'll send them one. I'll send them a good looking one. She want a man, I'ma send them one. The day you better have a credit report, a police report, and everything else, anything else that the Holy Spirit will put on you to make sure that you know. We talk about being real. I love it because my mentor's church, they have a slogan there, real, and relevant. and relational. All right? So we need to be real today. I heard a young lady say that was up here earlier. She said, I want to make it real because you don't understand where I'm coming from. You don't understand what I have to go back home to. And many of us don't know what you might have to go back home to, or what you might have to go back home to, or what you have waiting at home. How you got to go through some stuff just to get into your own house. How you got to fight through some streets just to get there and pray that a bullet doesn't come through your window.
Yes.
So I don't know your story. I